Hello all, and good evening everyone. I am Karthik Dheerashree, and I would like to welcome you all today on behalf of GDG Cloud Ahmedabad organizing team. First of all, I would like to congratulate all of you. We are now a family of more than 3,000 members on our meetup group. And I know you all must be really excited and looking forward to learn what is a serverless computing and what are some of the products and how you could use it for the same. So let's invite two of our guests today. We have Guillaume joining in from France. He is the lead cloud architect at Viol, and he's also a Google developer expert on GCP. He's been into tech industry for more than 15 years, working on Java, Python, and Go. And we also do have one more speaker today, Jigar Nawadia from our own organizing team. He's currently working as the data engineering lead at DX Factor, and he's also a Google certified data scientist and cloud architect. So let's not keep all of you awaited and bring them to share their thoughts.
Yep. Thank you,
Please.
Karthik, for warm welcome.
Thank you. Welcome, everybody. I'm not sure that you are viewing my screen. Is it okay? Thanks everyone to be here. Today's session, I would like to present with Jigar what are the serverless products on GCP? What are they, the different products, especially on compute part? When to use them, which are the best use case for this product, and how to switch from one product to another one, because sometimes your requirements need to switch to switch your choice at the beginning. So just we who are the speaker? I'm speaking today. I'm very glad to speak with Jigar, and I'm Google, Guillaume Black here. I'm working at Veolia. Veolia is a big French company, in fact, focused on environmental businesses, water, waste, and energy. We are big in France, and we are also present in 50 countries in the world. So just let's jump to the presentation now. What's the serverless? We talk about a lot of serverless. It's a trendy word today. Most of people talked about serverless, what it is. In fact, we have two ways to see the serverless. The first part is the operational model, the easiest for everybody. You have nothing to worry about the server, the network, the patching, the high availability, the backups, and so on. All the technical parts is managed by the cloud provider. And one additional bonus of this, you pay only when you use the service. For example, a cloud function, when you run your function, you pay. When your function didn't run, you pay nothing, and you can scale to zero. And if nobody used your service, you pay nothing. It's not really true for all the serverless products. Sometimes we call also the managed product. For example, on GCP also, you have Cloud SQL. It's a managed database, relational database on GCP, like MySQL, PostgreSQL, or Microsoft SQL Server. And when you run a managed instance, you have nothing to worry about the server, the patching, the upgrade of the platform. All these parts are managed by Google, but you pay even if your database is not used. I mean, if you're the night and the weekend, for example, if you have no request on your database, you will continue to pay the server that run your database. So the pay as you use is not always true in the serverless and the managed services. The other way to see what is serverless is to focus on the developer side. In fact, a developer, a programmer, when he would like to develop something, he develop a service, a microservices, because it's the best pattern today, and then service answer to events, cloud events, or maybe HTTP events. It's an external event, but it's also an event. And the target of the developer is to bring value to his customer. He doesn't care where the service is deployed, on GCP, on AWS, on-premises. He doesn't care of this. He wants a service portable, and it's his vision of serverless. He don't care which server run his services. He only wants the service run somewhere and to deliver the value to the customers. So when we look at to GCP, which products are available in serverless, you have a lot of products on database, analytics, AI, messaging, and so on. And today, the focus will be on the center of this part, is the compute with Cloud Run, Cloud Function, and App Engine. So just we will perform a focus on these three products. And the first one, the Cloud Function, the most simple, will be presented by Jigar.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Glenn. Yep. So if you see the serverless era, right? So it started with this event-driven processing and all that, right? So one of the my favorite, and I think most of the serverless who loves this technology, right? So that's the Cloud Function. So it's totally event-driven, right? Very simple to use for the developers, because most of the time, as a developers, we would like to minimize the deployment process and make it available, our services make it available as speed as we want, right? So if we see the Cloud Function, right? So that comes with, different features, right? Services on cloud platform itself. So when we say Cloud Function, right? There is a serverless, right? So what it does means basically. So you don't need to, provide or provision any sort of configuration, any sort of environment to be created and set up, right? To host your app, your APIs or your code, right? It does automatically, take care of whatever, language environment and, your programming version that you select, right? So majorly, if you see the Cloud Function, on the Google Cloud, it comes with two types of function. One is HTTP driven, and another is the background functions. So we'll talk about it little bit in the later use cases. But yeah, so another application that you can see, it scales, right? It auto scales with your usage. So if your traffic, you are not certain about the number of users or number of requests that you will get on your application, right? You can always go with a serverless kind of model, especially on the Cloud Functions, right? Where you have a small jobs like processing some files, right? And giving a response and quick updates in database, right? You wanted to do if this event occurs, right? Let's say if database has new records, you wanted to pick up that records and you wanted to put it in your staging environment, or you wanted to duplicate that record into your analytics environment, right? So those kind of use cases that you can do. Of course, you can also use it for your mobile backend as well. And the serverless comes with, there is no upfront payment that you need to do. There are 2 million invocations absolutely free for you, right? So up to that, you can use the Cloud Functions, and then there will be a payment. And the charges is very minimal, right? It's you can check it on Google Cloud billing page itself. So some of the use cases that if we talk about, right? So where you wanted to do the event processing, right? So what it does means basically. So let's say if you have your application which does have some event tracking. So basically, if something happens on this, if user uploads the image or user uploads his information, registration data, you wanted to pick it up and you wanted to do further processing, right? So those use cases you can do, right? If this happens on my environment, right? You wanted to do the action on that. So where the cloud functions fits the most, right? So one of the thing is, you know, real-time stream processing. So let's say if you are working on the analytics tracking, right, and you wanted to process your data, or let's say you are working on, you know, ML APIs where you wanted to process any document, image, or, you know, wanted to build it a conversational UI, right? So those quick actions that you can perform on the cloud function, you can send that data, right? You can write your core logic, it will perform, and it will, you know, do the action that you have already put in there. It's very quick, very easy to use, and very, you know, fast to execute as well, right? So another use case is real-time file processing, right? So let's say if you want to process your documents, right? Whether it is bank statement or insurance document, right? And you wanted to leverage the ML APIs on Google Cloud, right? You can quickly use cloud functions, because cloud function does come up with, you know, pre-built authentication of your other cloud or the Google APIs, right? So Google APIs, I'm sure you guys are aware, like there is a vast amount of, you know, API pools that Google provides, be it map, right? The ML APIs, right? And analytics API, there are the tool ecosystem that Google provides, all the APIs are authenticated with the cloud functions. You just need to, you know, enable those APIs, and you are ready to, you know, use for your, whether it is file processing, it is image processing, or you wanted to, you know, convert your text, or you wanted to generate a sentiment out of it, right? So those kind of, you know, use cases that you can use with the cloud function, right? And the, you know, the fourth one, like, you know, you can link it with your existing product like a queue, right? So that's the perfect definition or the, you know, layman term for the cloud functions. When you have a, let's say your mobile application, and you wanted to ensure that, you know, your image upload service gets scaled, right, with your existing environment, right? So you can independently develop this service and integrate with your mobile application or web application, right? And it's an independent service, so it's not tightly coupled with your application. So if anything else goes down, this will not go down, right? So that's how the serverless ecosystem works. So some of the use cases on the enterprise and the e-commerce and services, like I can give you some of the use cases for the, let's say, e-commerce, very known use case and very known industry as well, right? So when you order something on the e-commerce, right, you wanted to send, you wanted to track that transaction into analytics, you know, environment, or you're in data warehouse, right? So what you can do, once that transaction get records in your transaction database, right, you can trigger your cloud function, which does record your exact what products and what transaction that user has done. You can put it into data warehouse, and that further can be leveraged for your recommendation engine or your personalization system. Or you can also create another cloud function which does do the event processing further in terms of one step more, and do these, you know, send an email or SMS to the end user who has purchased the products, right? So those are the quick services or solutions that you can, you know, develop with the cloud function. And with the recent updates of cloud functions in this July month only, right now cloud function does provide your Node.js latest version, which is 12, and also the Python 3.8, right? So now you can, you know, leverage those programming environment as well. We will also see a demo in the later slides.
Yeah, okay. Just to finish on cloud function, you also have some new languages that's coming, like .NET and Ruby, yeah, is coming on cloud function. I don't have a release date, but I hope in 2020, by the end of the year, maybe these two new languages will be added to the cloud functions. So thank you, Jiga, for the cloud function. The function is really small for single purpose, for linking a product to another one. And when you want to build something more complex, I mean with microservices, and you want to deploy these microservices for serving a website, you can use App Engine. App Engine is really it's the first Google Cloud product released in 2008, 12 years ago. And this first product is to deploy the code that you want, the website that you want, without any configuration when you deploy it. Only bring your web server and then deploy it, and it scale automatically with your traffic. App Engine have two flavors, the standard version and the flex version. So the flex version, I don't recommend it to you now with new product like Cloud Run. I don't recommend you to use flex version, but the standard version is very efficient. A lot of companies use it, and my company starts with App Engine and the standard version, and it's very efficient. The use cases for this web-oriented platform are, for example, the service mobile backends, not for a single function, a single purpose, and a single process, but for a real backend with microservices for updating data in a database, querying the data, updating the data, and so on. It's really designed for multi-microservices web application because you have a default service on App Engine, and then you can deploy a lot of other services, and you can plug all the services to communicate and to perform your workload. Another powerful feature of App Engine is the traffic splitting. What you can do when you split the traffic, you can redirect the traffic to one version or to another version, and you can perform pattern like A-B testing to be sure that one version is more efficient than the other one in the number of users that validate a cart, the number of payments, the number of likes. I don't know what you want to have as input and metrics, but you can test two versions in parallel. In addition, you can have some deployment management difference. You can have Boolean deployments and canary deployment to be sure when you deploy a new version in production, is this new version work as expected or not? And you can perform a rollout very quickly because you can split the traffic and route the traffic 100% of the traffic to the previous version, and then to perform a rollback very easily. This service is really web oriented. Of course, you can perform a small operation like a CLED function. Of course, you can host API and you can expose API to the internet with these services, but the main purpose is to host a web application because you can deploy your backend and your frontend, and you can serve a static file on your frontend on a service, and you pay nothing because it's a static file. There is no processing and no instance to create on the App Engine side, and so you pay nothing for serving your static files. And for a website, it's a good thing to do. Another service is Cloud Run. Cloud Run, like App Engine, you have to host a web server, but this time this web server is packaged in a container. And with Cloud Run, you can deploy a container in production. As the CLED function and App Engine, you scale automatically to zero and to n instances according with your traffic. And a special particularity of Cloud Run is the compliance with Knative. So just a word on Knative. Knative is a product developed initially by Google and now in open source. And this product comes on top of Kubernetes. It's also a product developed by Google initially and now in open source. And Kubernetes, the main purpose, and quickly, the main purpose of Kubernetes is to manage a cluster of VM. So the VM are named node, and you have a node pool on your cluster, and you can deploy on this node some pods. A pod, in fact, is one or several containers into a pod. And when you deploy your application, you have a set of resources, your node pool, your VM with memory and CPU, and you want to deploy application software containers on this on this node. And the power of Kubernetes is in fact to deploy easily and to scale easily the number of pods and the number of nodes automatically. You can define if 60% of my CPU is used, add another pod. And if you add another pod, maybe you have not enough resources on your cluster, you can say to Kubernetes, if you have not enough resources in the cluster, you can create automatically a new VM, add it to the node pool, and then deploy the new pod on this VM. So you have a lot of ops operation performed automatically by Kubernetes. Another one, for example, you have EC checks of your pod. If the pod is an LC, it's evicted from the cluster and a new one is created. Same thing for the VM, for the node. If a node is an LC, the node is destroyed and another one is created. And you have also feature for the rollout and so on. So you have a lot of stuff very interesting with Kubernetes. But the problem with Kubernetes, that you scale according with the usage of the CPU and the memory. And for example, when you have a Black Friday and you have a lot of connection on your site in the morning at 8 a.m. because you have a lot of promotion and a lot of all sales on your website, Kubernetes scale very slowly because it's only according with your CPU and your memory. And with Knative, the scaling, in fact, is performed according with the number of requests that you have on your cluster. If you have no request, you have no pod deployed on your cluster, you have one request. The Knative agents, in fact, deployed on the Kubernetes cluster, check the request, check if a pod exists. If no pod exists, a new pod is created and the request is routed to this pod. I just would like to focus on this part. If there is nothing deployed, if there is no pod, Knative create a new pod and route the request. When the creation of the pod, sometimes it can take time. And in serverless parts, the initialization of your context to set up BDD database connection, to set up some environment variables and so on, can take times. And if your container is deployed in 20 or 30 seconds, the request waits the duration of the deployment and then will be routed to the container. And it takes a lot of time, and the user that click on the button waits 20 or 30 seconds for having an answer. And it's not very efficient. Keep in mind that with serverless, you scale to zero. And when you start your application, the application needs to start very quickly. And for example, when you use Spring Boot is very slow at the beginning. And I love Spring Boot. I'm a Java developer at the beginning and I love Spring Boot. But for the serverless context, Spring Boot is not the best candidate for the serverless. So it's just a piece of advice for you. And why Knative is interesting? Because you can install Knative on top of any Kubernetes cluster. You can deploy Knative on AWS, on premises, on Azure, of course, on GCP. And thus, when you have a Cloud Run container, when you have a container compliant with Cloud Run, is also compliant with Knative, and you can deploy this container on GCP, on AWS, on Azure, without changing your container. It's compliant by default. Two constraints for this: your container need to be stateless. I mean, you can't mount a volume into your container. You know, it's only stateless. You can communicate with stateful services like database services or with cloud storage for storing the file. And the service have to answer to HTTP requests. That's great for API and for websites. And thus, which use case are the best for Cloud Run? For me, all, because I'm a big fan of Cloud Run, but honestly, the API backends for serving API REST or API in gRPC, Cloud Run is the best for this. Another use case is when you are locked with serverless limitation. When you have a look on Cloud Function, today we have four languages available: Go, Node, Python, and Java. Java in beta. And if you are, for example, a .NET developer, you can use Cloud Function. You can have a look to App Engine with Go, Node, Python, Java, Ruby, and PHP. If you are a .NET developer, you can't use App Engine. And with Cloud Run, because you package your container and you deploy your container, you have not this limitation. You can use the language that you want, and you can also install the libraries and the binaries that you want on this container, because you own your container and you deploy what you want inside. And as mentioned before, when you have portability requirements, it's very interesting because it's a container, and the container, you can run it where you want. You can also run your Cloud Run container on a VM. You perform a Docker run and you run your container. It works, and you can also deploy it on Knative if you want, or on Kubernetes and so on. You will lose the serverless capabilities, but you can deploy your container anywhere you want. So that was for the three main products on GCP for hosting your code in serverless way. And sometime we'll start with one solution because your use case match, for example, your use case match the Cloud Function, and you start with Cloud Function, and sometime the requirement evolves, and you have to add more feature, to add more function, and you have 5, 10, 15, 20 function to manage, and it's too complicated to manage. You would like to group all these functions in the same service, in the same microservices, because the functions are similar. You share the same piece of code. You share the same purpose in each function, and you have to package all these functions in the same service. Sometimes, and it's more and more the case, the customers require a portability of your development. The customers don't want to be locked in GCP and AWS on Azure or something else. They want to have the choice to deploy somewhere. And if you start with Cloud Function, you need to repackage your function to be portable, for example, in Cloud Run, to be deployed anywhere. And you have also some technical constraints. I already mentioned some before. For example, you have a language to choose to change the language for performance. Maybe you have to develop in C++ or Rust, because you have to be very, very efficient when you process something. You need to install some libraries or binaries for reaching a database or something like this. For example, if you would like to reach a database with Oracle, you can do this only with Cloud Run. You can do this with App Engine or Cloud Function, because you have to install an Oracle binaries on your application, on your server, and you can't with Cloud Function and App Engine. And you can with a container. You can install what you want inside. And maybe sometimes you need more customization on your web server and not to use what is delivered by default on GCP. So now, how to switch? I will just perform you a presentation, a demo with my code. I will start, I think it's better like this. I will start a new project. I will show you how it's easy to switch from Cloud Function to App Engine to Cloud Run. I will just start a new project. I will start in Go because I prefer to develop in a Golang, but you can. I will show you a demo of Python just after. So I just create my project here. and I'm start with a very simple project with nothing inside. Here, okay, I have nothing. Just now, I will switch to the getting started for the cloud function. I will perform you a live demo without any preparation, and I will just copy paste what is recommended here in the documentation of Google Cloud. I create a new file here, for example, main.go. Okay, perfect. And I copy paste. I will just simplify the hello world. And I just would like to print here hello from Go. And just go back. And I would like to add an header here. And I would like to say it's OK. So that's all. Just to optimize the import. OK. Now it's OK for this. I will. Yeah. I think it's better like this. So now I have a simple function to deploy on GCP. I will deploy it in command line, gcloy function deploy. Okay. I will deploy a trigger HTTP function. Okay. I will allow anyone to connect to my function. I will deploy it in the region. For example, this one that I use for all my tests. And what else? What I forget? Yes, the runtime, of course. So the runtime is here in Go.
Sorry to interrupt. Can you zoom a bit more?
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah.
Is it better?
Bit more. Yep. Now I think it's visible. Yep.
Okay. Perfect. So here I use Go 1.11 runtime because I found an issue with 1.13. So don't worry with this. I open an issue, and then you have to name your function. Two cases: either you use exactly the same name as the function here, or you can say, no, I don't want to use the name of my function in my code, so I just mention here which is the entry point in my code, and I can customize my the name of my function here, and then I can deploy it on GCP. So just during the deployments, now I would like to present you what's the equivalence in Python. In Python here, continue to zoom in. Yeah, here in Python, the function is only this. Now the next step for me is to create a web server, because when you have a function, it's only a function, nothing more. And I have to create a real web server to use App Engine or Cloud Run. So in Go is quite simple. I have to create a main function, but because it's a main function, I have to rename my package here in main. That's all. And now I can run my function. First step, I have to start my web server. I use HTTP, the standard library of Go, and I can create a server like this, listen and serve. I will listen on all the interfaces on my PC. So I don't specify any IP, but I will specify here the port. And I have no handler to specify. So perfect. Now I have to add the function to my web server. For this, here again, it's quite simple. I have a handle function. I say, when I call the roots of my web server, I would like to call my hello world function. And that's all. And of course, if you have 2, 3, 5 many functions, you can add several endpoints like this and call all these functions. And it's easy to package all your functions in one when in one web server. So here my function has been correctly deployed. Here I have a link, I can click on it, and yes, I can see my hello world from Go. Perfect, that's work. Now let's go with my web server. I can test it locally. Just a remark for you, when I created my function, I can't test it locally. Now my web server, I can test it, and sometimes it's easier to test locally your function before deploying on GCP. That's why I prefer to have a web server on my side. And even for your test, you can do this. It's easier for you. Here I can start my web server. Yes, it started locally. And now I can just perform a curl localhost 8080. And okay, I have my answer. Good. I will stop my web server. And now I would like to deploy on App Engine. For App Engine, you can specify a lot of stuff, the scaling capabilities and a lot of stuff, the static files and so on. But the minimal things to specify is the runtime that we would like to use. So you create a new file here, name at app.yaml, and you specify a runtime. It's Go 1.13, and that's all. Nothing more, and you can deploy on App Engine very, very easily like this. Just a remark here, I only wrap my function into my web server. I didn't change any line of code of my CLED function. Yes, I would like to deploy on App Engine. Now, during the deployment on App Engine, I would like to show you how to package this in a container. With a container, I need a container, a standard container for Go. Here again, just go back here. I would like to have a getting started with a CLED run in Go. And because I'm a lazy guy, I will just perform a copy paste of the documentation. Just here, I have a Docker file, just copy it. Here I can pass it a new file, name Docker file. Yes, and I passed the file. That's all. And now I have a functional container, Docker file for packaging my application and deploy it on CloudRun. I'll just create a new window here. And on my computer, I don't have Docker because it's a Windows computer and sometimes it's quite difficult to install Docker on the Windows computer. I would like to use Cloud Build. Cloud Build is a CI/CD on Google Cloud, and you can run, you can package your image on Cloud Build. For this, I will use Cloud Build. I will submit a job for the packaging. And I specify, I don't have a CI/CD pipeline. I ask only Cloud Build to package, to create a Docker image with this tag, gcr.io. Here I have to add my project name. Here my project ID. Here my ID, yes. And to name my container, it's my hello world.
Hey, sorry to interrupt you again. Can you zoom in, please?
Yeah, here for the Docker file.
Yeah.
Better, yeah, okay. It's only
better.
It's only the copy paste of the official Docker file in the Google documentation. If you want to copy it,
and
it's a very. So now I will submit this my code with this Docker file to Cloud Build, and I asked Cloud Build to make a container and to deploy it in Google Container Registry, GCR, Google Container Registry, in my project with this name and the version Docker. And I submit it. I think here it's okay. Okay, now I've finished my deployment on App Engine, and I can test it, and perfect, also it worked on App Engine. Just go back here. Sometimes Dockerfile, it's quite complicated because you have to learn something else because you have to create your Dockerfile, you have to customize it, and you have to perform a lot of things, and you have to know how to write a Dockerfile script. And there is a new feature on Google Cloud, an alpha feature that I would like to show you. It's based on a build pack. Build pack, it's a product in the CNCF, Cloud Native Computing Foundation. And this product detects automatically your code, the version, and package create a container automatically without a Dockerfile. For this, I will just delete my Dockerfile to demonstrate this. I will use Google Cloud, and you can use it on your side if you want. It's an alpha product. I will use build and submit just as before, but it's not a Dockerfile. It's a pack management. Yes, pack equal image. And I just have to specify my image here. I will copy paste this one. Okay, and here I will name it pack. So that's all. And without a Dockerfile, I can package the same container as before without writing nothing, and it's perfect. So switch back to the Cloud Run. Now I have my container image. I would like to deploy it on GCP. So gcloud, run for Cloud Run, deploy. What I would like to deploy? I would like to deploy an image. So this one with Docker. I would like to allow anybody to test it. I will deploy it on the region, same as before, central one. And what I would like to perform, to specialize the platform, I would like to use the platform managed, because you can also choose DKE or Kubernetes, but I prefer the serverless, and I prefer a managed platform. And now I can name my my service, Hello World Docker. And that's all. I can deploy on Cloud Run like this. Just during the deployment, Just during the deployment, I will switch back to the Python project to show you how to wrap a function like this into a web server. The web server in Python, most of the time, it's a light web server, it's Flask. So for this, you have to only import Flask and to create a Flask application. You have to add an annotation, a decorator on your function to say, as before, on the root and on the get method, you can trigger this piece of code, and you have to start your web server. And that's all. With only this few lines of code, you wrap a cloud function in Python in a web server in Python, and you can deploy it on App Engine or on Cloud Run very, very easily. And for me, it's easier to test my function with a web server locally than to deploy it on Google Cloud and so on. So just switch back here. My service has been deployed on Cloud Run, it's my Hello World Docker deployed. So I can click on it. Maybe to copy paste and go back here. Yes. And of course, it worked great. And if I go back to my packaging here, okay, the packaging is perfect with the pack version. I will deploy it again. So here it's not pack, it's not Docker, it's pack. And the tag also is not Docker, here it's pack. And in the same way, I can deploy the same container without a Docker file on Cloud Run. Just to finish this demo, and by waiting the deployment of this, I will just go on the UI of Google Cloud here, and I can show you what's happened. I deployed one cloud function here on cloud function. You can see it, it's hello GDG, and I deployed it here in 2 p.m. in France. It's not 6 p.m. like on your side. Here again, I have App Engine and different version for the default service, just deploy 4 minutes after. And now I have also Cloud Run, and I have two versions, Hello World Pack and Docker, and I can test it if I want here. Okay, just a last thing before going back to the slides. I've created two containers, and you can find the container in Google Container Registry just here. So I can see the Hello World with two tags, pack and Docker. And you have also an App Engine. App Engine is quite strange, but I would like to show you something very interesting. In the app, I think it's there. You have something named here, Build Pack. App Engine also use Build Pack for packaging your application before deploying it on App Engine. So at Google, everything is containers. And of course, App Engine is a container, and the container is built with Build Pack. So it was just for showing you this. So just to go back to the presentation, I will show you this. When you have a function, it's very easy to go from the function to package it into a web server, and then to deploy on App Engine with a simple file, very simple with one line, and to use Cloud Run and standard Docker file if you want. And also, you can skip the Docker file and use build pack. Of course, if you have customization to perform in your containers, build pack is not perfect because it's hard to customize your container with build pack. But if you have a standard application, a standard API REST without any specific stuff to install on your container, build pack is perfect. So what are the recommendations at the end for this presentation? I have four recommendations, and the first one, never perform over-engineering. Keep the stuff simple and stupid. Why? Because most of the time when you think maybe in the future it will be interesting too, the future never happen or rarely happen, but you create things very, very complicated, and it's hard to debug, it's hard to test, and please never perform over-engineering and keep the stuff simple, efficient. Write what the problem should do and not more. That's all. When the stuff are small and single purpose, use cloud function. When you have to deploy a web-oriented application with front-end and static files and the back-end, you can use App Engine. And if you want to have API-oriented, or if portability is required, or if you need some customization, you can use Cloud Run. This part is not very true today because 2 weeks ago, Google has released in beta something named serverless, global load balancer serverless. What it mean? You can now have a load balancer in front of all your serverless products, Cloud Function, App Engine, and Cloud Run. And you can also serve static files from a bucket. I mean, you have a load balancer, you can serve static files in the bucket, and you can serve your API with Cloud Run. And so with App Engine, it was interested to host your website because you have static files and backends in the same application. Now with serverless load balancer, you can do the same thing with the static files in the bucket and the API in Cloud Run or Cloud Function or App Engine. So the things are moving, and it's interesting to show you that I started with App Engine is web-oriented, but not exclusively now. Cloud Run can be used for this now. So that's all for me. I think it's okay. I would like to thank you, to thank the GDG and the GDG to host me and to be here with me today. And you can find the documentation of several products that I present you today. You can follow me or follow Jigar on Twitter. You can also contact me. I will be happy to answer your question or now or later on Twitter if you want. And I will be happy to meet you maybe a day in person. Thank you.
Thank you. So we can go in the question mode, guys, if you have any questions or...
So I'll check the chat. If there is some question. So no, the code that I presented is not written in Java. I wrote in Go because I prefer Go and it was my favorite language. And as mentioned before, I'm a Java developer and I'm a Spring Boot fan, and I started to develop in serverless way and in serverless world with Java and Spring Boot. And with serverless products, you have one or two CPU, and it's very slow to start a Spring Boot application. It takes about 15, 20, sometimes 30 seconds to start your application. And that's why I tried Python, but I prefer type-safe application and type-safe language. And that's why today I developed in Go, because Go starts very quickly. The memory footprint is very small and it's a type safe. And I prefer to develop with a type safe than with Python or Node, which are dynamic typing. And I don't like this, but it's my opinion. And yes, I also present the Python part. If you check some of my GitHub repository, most of the time I developed in Java, Go, Node, and Python to show you how to deploy a function, an App Engine, and a Cloud Run. And I can share you the link in the description if you want, in the slides, to this repository to show how to migrate from a function to a Cloud Run and App Engine in different languages.
Yep. So I think we can, take one question on this, the blue-green canary deployments, right? So what are the benefits? I'm sure most of the people have not used it in terms of, this serverless and the managed services. So if you can, throw some light on this blue-green canary deployments.
Yeah, I mentioned the blue-green deployment or the canary deployments with App Engine, but now you can also do this with Cloud Run, because with Cloud Run you have traffic splitting capabilities and you can do this. So the blue-green deployments, the objective of this is to deploy two versions in the same time, and you split the traffic about 50% for the whole application, and to see if the new one works as expected. And it's more efficient. In fact, it's like A/B testing for the blue-green deployment, is to be sure that the new application is more efficient. You have more like, more order, more view. I don't know what you want to improve, but it's at least the same, at least equal as the previous version. That I recommend when I deploy an application is not to perform a blue green deployment, but to perform a canary deployment. It's quite the same thing. In fact, you have two applications. You have to the new one and the previous one, and you have to split the traffic between the two, but it's not 50-50. It's 1% for the new application and 90% for the old application. And you can see with 1% of your traffic if you have some errors or not. If you have no errors with 1%, you can increase to 2, 3, 5% and to see, I don't know, 1 hour, 1 day, 1 week, if it's okay or not. And you can increase the percentage. And at the end, you switch 100 of the traffic from the old version to the new one because the new is it's okay because you are confident with the slight increase of the traffic.
Yeah, and I think we can say that, you know, if you wanted to do the incremental deployment and making your application live in, you know, some of the early users or maybe the beta users, or maybe you wanted to try your features, right, via IP testing, you can achieve that. So it's almost zero downtime, basically, that you can achieve with managed services.
Yeah, it's a zero downtime, and you when you perform A/B testing, canary or blue green for all this traffic splitting, you can choose randomly. You user can go on this part or on this part. You can choose this, or you can also say for this kind of users, I would like they use the new version because it's a set of alpha testers and so on, and for all the other users, go to the old version because you are unknown user and so on, and I don't want to lose you because you test a new version. The alpha users expect some bug and some issue, but the regular users don't expect this, and it's not not very good. And you can do this with the traffic splitting with App Engine. Not sure you can do this with Cloud Run today, but I think it's the future of the of the product. Just another thing that I would like to mention: when you deploy App Engine, Cloud Run, Cloud Function with service products, you have a regional high availability. I mean, when you deploy a VM on Google Cloud, you deploy a VM on a zone, and a zone is inside a region, in fact, and a region has three zones. And if you would like to have a high availability for your VM, you have to deploy three VM in the region to ensure the high availability. With the serverless product, the regional high availability is by default, and you don't have to deploy a lot of stuff. Only one function, and you have high availability by default.
Right. I think that's a good point to keep when you choose your different boards when you are deploying the application.
And most of the time, I would like to say, of course, when you compare the pricing of Cloud Function, Cloud Run, and the pricing of a compute, yes, it's more expensive if you run full time one VM and one Cloud Function. It's more expensive with Cloud Function, but you don't have to manage your network to patch your VM. You have regional high availability by default. You have no backup and so on. You have a lot of stuff to do less, and it's more efficient because you can focus your efforts on the code and on the development, and not on hosting and patching your VM and your infrastructure. That's why I prefer to present this, and I'm sure the serverless is the future of the cloud, but for now we are in the transient period where the people move from their data center to the cloud, and they want to see the same thing in the cloud that they had before in their data center, and it's like this.
Right. All right. So Yeah, I think we can end. There is no more question. If you guys have any questions, we will put this presentation. You can reach out to William or you can reach out to me, right, on Twitter, or maybe you can post it on Medium, right? If you have any questions, we'll definitely, you know, answer as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, just I will share the slides on Twitter, and I will tag the GGG, and you can get the slide like this.
All right. Yep.
So.
Okay. So thank you so much, Guillaume and Jigarbhai, for sharing your insights about serverless and how it can be done on Google Cloud. I hope this would be really good for the people who are starting to learn this. So thank you so much for joining in, and thank you so much everyone for even watching us online. Maybe you might be watching us live or even after some time. So thank you so much. Feel free to reach out to us at GDG Cloud Ahmedabad, me or Jigarbhai or Guillaume. Okay, goodbye all.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.